so a lot of you guys have been here before. This is our fifth month in a row to do this. We've had Mizzen and Maine come up here and speak. We've had the Texas' oldest boot company come and speak. We had my buddy Austin, who's an inventor and just a kind of jack of all trades. So actually, it's our fourth. And this afternoon, or this evening, we've got somebody that means a lot to me and a lot to everybody watching and a lot of people that are here. This is my friend Spencer Nix. Spencer and I met 7 years ago at CrossFit, and I was trying to think of a way that I could introduce him. By the way, we've got people watching online, and we're going to record it and put it on our YouTube channel as well. But I was trying to think of a way to go and describe you and just a word that I would use. And on the Facebook post, I put pioneer, but a word that I would use would be impact. And what Spencer has taught me, and I believe 14,500 other people, is that what the number is?
And counting.
Yeah, so almost 15, was that right, that the statistic?
Yeah.
So, so no, truly, that's a real number. Almost 15,000 people. He's a fitness guy, but he's really more of a, he's a sophisticated stoic. And the approach that Spencer has taken to his business is much like what my dad has taught me, who's in this room. It's not what you do, it's how you do it. So my lead in to Spencer is at my company, at my real estate company, and you guys watching, it's info@rogershealy.com for all your real estate needs. thank you. Once a month we used to have a speaker come up and share their sales story. Everybody from my dad to me to just run-of-the-mill salespeople, and Spencer came up about a year and a half ago. And his speech immediately changed the trajectory of my approach to business. He came up there, and he's going to share a lot of what he's going to share today, but the one takeaway I had, my question at the end was based on just redundancy and how do you go and stay interested in the stuff that's not interesting. And I asked him, I was like, how do you go and get excited about someone asking you how to do a back squat? Right, like me, when I started, I literally didn't know how to do back squat, a pull-up, whatever. And instantly his response was, it's the first time that they've done it. Period. He's like, it's the first time they've done that back squat. So just as far as a mindset is concerned, this guy encapsulates every bit of it from an entrepreneur perspective as well. So he's going to share our story with us, and we're going to start off with the question of just the Spencer story. How did it happen, and how did you lead to where you are today?
As far as me as a...
You've seen the question. question number one. Yeah. What's your story? And then in quotes, how did Spencer happen? Not literally, but like... Spencer.
It's a hard question to answer, kind of.
Let's start this. Spencer, where were you born?
I'm from... So, because everyone in here is from Dallas, I had to come clean and say I'm not from Dallas, but I'm actually from Terrell.
He's the second most, on his business card, the second most famous resident from Terrell. Right behind Jamie Funk.
That's right. So grew up in Terrell, small town. Some of these other questions that Rogers will ask, I guess we'll provide a little more color commentary to this.
Dude, you literally have the socks on. I was asking if you've seen them, and you have the exact same socks on.
Well, yeah, but you did like a Mr. Rogers like sock change when you came out. I didn't know if that was like a regular thing that you did. You get home and out with the old and with a fresh pair.
Keds.
Yeah.
Okay, Terrell.
Terrell.
1973.
Yeah. I'm one of six kids, so Steven is not just somebody I like, but actually related to. I'm the oldest of five boys, and I have an older sister, so a pretty large family. Small town, went to Texas A&M for undergrad, went to UTD to get a master's, and in 2008 we opened up the gym, and so we've been doing that for 10 plus years now.
And you guys that aren't familiar with CrossFit, and first of all, how do you know, the joke is, how do you know someone does CrossFit?
They'll tell you,
right? And I would hear about this, and I'm obsessed with what we do at my company with the culture. And the first four letters of culture are cult. And I think that CrossFit literally has the greatest culture ever. But I would hear about these people talking about it, and our old office was a half a block away, and I just shied away from it because I didn't understand it. But you guys were the first CrossFit in at least Dallas, right?
Yeah.
And how many are there now?
I think it's estimated like close to 15,000 worldwide, and it's kind of and we'll talk about this, you know, it's kind of tapered off within the states, but globally it's growing considerably. South America, I think South America is the biggest place that it's growing. South America right now feels like 2008 in like the states. I mean, it's just wild, and it's growing in Asia and over in Europe and stuff like that. But yeah, like a little bit more details, and this will probably like answer some of these other questions that I'm looking at right now. But I wasn't, I think there's probably a misconception that if someone's in the fitness industry, it's like, oh, you're really good at fitness, you know, or like you should be. And growing up, like I wasn't an athlete. That wasn't, you know, like when you're in high school, you fall into like a group or kind of a clique, like the athletics group was not my group, you know, like I had, you know, some complications as a kid where allergies were really severe. Like I had four or five like hospitalizations for adolescent asthma growing up, and two big influences from my mom, my dad's side. My dad's a dentist, and so I thought I would go into medicine as like a more kind of cultured offshoot of what my dad was doing. And my mom's uncle, who was a mentor of mine, was the assistant secretary of defense and was like a Navy man. So I thought, okay, I'll be a doctor in the Navy, right? That was like the trajectory growing up. And out of high school, like not super athletic again, but
no, it's time to fix the dogs. It's
a great
documentary if you guys haven't seen it, but
we only got a little bit left.
This is such a good documentary.
Wait, Rogers, focus.
Oh yeah, well, yeah.
I'm sorry. Time to promote.
Okay, sorry, CrossFit.
And there I
Doctor,
was.
Doctor, maybe.
Yeah.
Hero.
Yeah.
Turn it off. Yeah. Can you just get that bigger mic? That's the right button. Thank you.
Wrong red button.
The bigger mic just. Okay. Now we're back. I did
press the red button. It would have been hard to compete with that. Really.
The voice would have been hard.
Sorry. Live TV, people. This is part of it.
There's a point I'm trying to make that I applied to the Naval Academy. I was like, that's where I'm going. That's the vision. That's the dream. And I did get accepted, not for academics, right? That was kind of my niche in high school. Like I was in the kind of the smart kids club, and I was in theater, and I was in the band, right? But I had a congressional appointment. So if you know like the process to get into the service academies is quite extensive. And so I had done, in my mind, like all the stuff that was really hard. And I didn't get accepted because I failed the medical. So you had to go through a qualification test, just like if you were going into the military. And because of my asthma, they said you can't be accepted, right? So I was devastated. And as a fallback, and anybody who's an Aggie, like I had no idea of like the culture there, nothing, but they had a great reputation of having an ROTC program there. So I thought, hey, I'll join that. And there was kind of like this backdoor route to the service academies that if you went and did the ROTC at A&M, then you could somehow like matriculate into their program, you know, as a sophomore or something like that. And so I got to A&M, and there's quite a bit of culture, and there's a lot of stories there. But I was immediately put in this remedial PT group with guys that were obese and me, right? Because like I couldn't run, like I couldn't sustain the pace that the group goes on for runs in the morning, right? I would fall back every time. And so because I fell back so much, they were like, you have to be in this group with, you know, the guys that also can't run, but like they were all just really overweight and out of shape. So there were a few like experiences where I wasn't coming from a place of like surplus and like, man, I have all this fitness and God is great. this athleticism, so let me enter into the fitness business. Like, I have great empathy and sympathy for people that walk into the gym that are overweight, that walk in, that have...
You know, when he said that, he looked right at me.
That are overweight. That, you know, like we had a guy this morning, I said, hey, why are you here? And, you know, people usually give, like, the same responses, like, I want to look good with my shirt off, and the doctor said, and this guy said, I have a history of diabetes, and I just got diagnosed with, like, type 2. And it's that, like, mantle of responsibility that we have that just takes me, like, right back. And not that, like, yeah, I had asthma, so it's like having diabetes. That's not what I'm trying to say. But it's, like, on the sliding scale of, like, I got into this not because I thought it was, like, great at it. I got into it because my life had been, like, completely changed and transformed. Not because of anything intellectually, but it was, like, something physical that happened that, like, there was this moment, and I remember the moment, right, where, like, I felt like I had just a slight bit of control over something that up until that point I thought was completely out of the realm of me having anything to do with, like, positively. Does that make sense? And
yeah.
I don't know if I can relate to that, but that was kind of...
So, yeah, one of the first things I heard about you is, didn't you almost participate in the Olympics?
Yeah.
Yeah, so to go from, like, the chubby band dork to the Olympics, there's something we probably missed. But maybe share that story and talk about how you found CrossFit or how CrossFit found you.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we'll pick up where we left off, right? I was in the core, and this became my obsession because now I was getting, like, objective feedback that I was, like, not good enough. Before, it was just kind of just me, right? But now, being in a group of guys, and it was like, hey, you can't participate in all this stuff, like, it became my obsession to figure this out. And, you know, there was a book called Body for Life. Does anyone remember this book? Something Phillips is his name, I forget. Anyways, I read that, I did the nutrition stuff, and I, like, was running nonstop, and I actually, like, got in good shape at the time and by my, you know, standards. And slowly but surely, like, this thing that was once a deficit became, like, this obsession. And then as things started to get better, meaning I could run a little bit better and I got in better shape, like, it became fun. And also, I had, like, a growth spurt. Right, I was like a late bloomer, and so also, like, as a sophomore in college, like, I graduated high school, I'm 225 and I'm 6'2", and in high school I was this height and 160. A little slightly different, right? So some of it was probably just, you know, Mother Nature, like, giving me some better equipment to work with, I guess you could say. And so college, like, this was something that became, like, something I was, like, super stoked about and passionate about, and wanted to learn more, and was excited about this and interested in it, and even took on work. My first job was in, like, a nutrition store off campus, and then somebody asked me if I wanted to train people. I was like, yeah, absolutely, that sounds great. So I was doing some of that on the side, and then actually worked a little bit with A&M and, like, their strength conditioning department, and then went off to Stafford, Texas, and worked at what I thought was going to be a dream job, training guys for, like, the NFL combine. You know, this was Plex in Stafford, Texas, and there were some big name professional athletes that trained there. And at the time, my brother Sam, who was I guess, like, just entering in as a freshman at SMU, caught wind of CrossFit through Men's Journal, like, the top 50, like, fitness websites. And so it hadn't taken me long to have a little bit of hubris when it came to, like, strength conditioning and fitness, right?
Yeah, so, quick question.
Yeah.
Was hubris?
kind of like ego, you know, like a little bit of cockiness when it came to that stuff. And so Sam, my little brother, he's telling me about something fitness related. It's like, hey, little brother, you know, I've had 5 or 6 years like really digging into this stuff. You know, I just worked with Roger Clemens. So, you know, are you going to tell me that I need to check something out? But anyways, I went on to the website and I tried to work out, and I kind of cherry picked the first one. And is everybody familiar with CrossFit? I mean, at least like periphery, even if you don't participate in it yet.
Yes.
Okay, great. There's lots of different workouts, and I picked one that was just pull-ups, which I liked to do. So the first one I did, I was like, this is stupid, you know. I tried it again, and I was in the Lifetime Fitness in Sugar Land, Texas, and I did this what seemed to be a really simple combination of pull-ups and then this weird movement where you squat down and then you press a bar overhead, like a squat press, which they called a thruster. And it was like 3 stupid rounds. I was like, that's easy. And the reps even got less each round. So it was like 21, and then it was 15, and then it was 9. I was like, this is going to be the easiest thing ever. And I did it, and it just floored me. The combination and how the blood shuttles from parts of the body, and like this beautiful synthesis of like pulling with pushing and squatting. And I was just like laying on the ground after the workout. And what I didn't know is in Lifetime, a guy had died like the week before. It was like an old guy, he had cardiac arrest. Christ. And so they came over to me, like, oh, and they put the AED on me. You know, like they put the machine on me. They're like, are you okay? I was like, and I couldn't talk at the time. I was like, I don't think
welcome to CrossFit.
So that was like my first experience. As far as like the workouts go. But remember I told you about medical school, right? So even in college, I still was on that track. I took the MCAT, I did all that stuff. But there was this point where I realized that like it probably wasn't going to be my vocation, it wasn't gonna be my career. But my old man was still letting me go and interview at different medical schools. And so I kind of got wind of CrossFit and that the main headquarters was in Santa Cruz, right? That's where like the original CrossFit gym was. And I told Sam, I was like, hey, I'm pretty sure I can get Dad to pay for a trip for us to go out to San Francisco, interview at this medical school, and then we'll spend the rest of the time at like the original CrossFit gym. And it was a great trip. It's like some really funny stories. We went to Napa, and this lady, I'll tell you later.
Yeah, it's an incredible story. How'd the interview go?
Short. Yeah, not too long. And then we spent the rest of the time in Santa Cruz, and it was that trip where Sam and I experienced their little community and how like the movements and the workouts are really just the sideshow to what's really going on. Mm-hmm. And after we experienced that, we were like, I mean, no joke, I know this sounds like silly, but we were like, our life will never be the same. Like, it'll never be the same. And to be like you know, because this was 2006, right? So to be on, it would be like listening to the Beatles for the first time when nobody knew about it, right? And you're like, this is so good, you know, like, this is so good. It was one of those things, right, where you catch wind of something that you just know is going to be awesome, and we just kind of went from there. Like, you could just go on the website, and in 2006, 2007, you just did the workouts. Like, there were no gyms, right? You just did the workouts. These workouts, though, they were so encompassing that there were lots of different movements. You had to have specialized gear. And so there was a point where Sam and I couldn't just keep going. I was in grad school at the time, right? We couldn't just keep going to the SMU rec center and like dropping their weights on the ground. Like they really frowned upon it. There was a big no-no there. So we had to find like some of the extra equipment. At first we went out to our house in Terrell and we made makeshift gear, right? So we made our own kettlebells. We like duct taped circular change plates together and like made like this makeshift handle. It's really rad stuff. We had saw horses that we set this barbell that we got from a junkyard. And so every squat for the first 2 years we had to start from a rock bottom position, stand up and then like back down to the sawhorses. And we made rings, like we made a lot of stuff. But it got to a point, and we would bring people out there and be like, hey, do this workout. And try to make him throw up. It got to a point where we had to expand a little bit, right? And we had to get enough suckers together so they could pay for the gear that we couldn't make in our garage and home.
Is anybody in here an original member of one of the original ones?
Yeah, you
were what, 6 months?
Yeah, Jack have been around since the very beginning. Yeah.
And Murphy and I started a couple.
They can still see out of both their eyes. Jack drills a little bit, but not
a little bit. We started at the CrossFit Plains at Troy Dodson.
Yeah.
You remember there for a minute.
Yeah.
So how did CFDC come about? Like, what was the defining moment where you actually went and put a business plan together and decided to launch it?
We had my brother and I and a third friend from A&M who was in real estate, and so he found a location which was on Dyer Street, and it was 25 cents a square foot in 2008. And so we were just kind of doing the math. It was
25 cents.
Yeah. And we were like, okay. This is, and if you saw it, like, it was worth 25 cents a square foot. Like, I probably have cancer because of, like, cleaning the asbestos out of the ceiling and stuff. There wasn't, embarrassingly enough, there wasn't much of a business plan. We decided that we would each raise $8,000 between the three of us. So we had, you know, 24 grand to start the business. And basically we thought, if we could just get this many people to offset the expenses, that would be enough for us, right? If we could just have enough to get bumper plates and like one real kettlebell and one real rower, like that would be good enough for us. And so we convinced our parents, and I think my dad's told me this several times since, like, we didn't think we'd ever see that money again, fellas, you know. But anyways, that was pretty much it. I think that there wasn't really any long-term, like, trajectory or pro formas. There was no spreadsheets, right? It was just like, we'll have a PayPal account, we'll get affiliated with CrossFit, we'll just open the doors.
What was the process for getting affiliated? Is that a pretty grueling process?
It's pretty much the same today. You have to write an essay to CrossFit headquarters. You have to be certified through their educational, seminars, and then you have to pay an affiliate fee, and you get listed on their like massive website of like places to go. So in 2008, we did that, and it was us and four other places like in Texas that you could go to. And if somebody found us, we knew that they went through that website because it was the only marketing and the only exposure that we had to get new members. We didn't do any marketing, and it was notorious enough that it was cool, right? Because if somebody walked in, it was like, you know exactly what you're getting into, you know, in the early days.
So what was your mindset? Like, obviously, it was kind of not a hobby, but it wasn't something that you had a long-term vision for. What did you realistically expect when you opened the doors?
I think that we knew we would get some really early adopters that were in the same place that we were. So we knew that they would probably be guys. There wasn't a female that stepped into the gym for like the first, over a year, I think. We knew they'd be local. We knew that they would know what CrossFit was. And truly, Rogers, like at the beginning, that was pretty much as far as it went. We just thought, hey, let's see how far we can take this. You know, like, we think this is a cool concept. And there was a point, maybe a year in, where we realized, like, hey, we're not bad at this either. You know, like, there wasn't this acumen, like, this precursor, like, hey, I'm good at this, so that's why I'm doing it. I think we were just, like, really stoked and really passionate about doing the program ourselves. But then we kind of crossed this chasm where it's like, hey, Sam and I both really like helping people, and the community thing that went with that, it was like, we really like having these relationships with people that are way different than some of the other relationships we had. And anybody who's done CrossFit, like, you get this. the second you step in, it's like this beautiful egalitarian like society where everybody's on the same footing. And so, you know, I'm able to have like these cool relationships with people that I may not have been able to in a different context, you know.
So did you ever think anybody else was gonna open another CrossFit?
You know, at the beginning, there were so few. I think anyone that opened one, it was like being on Mars. And you want me to be really honest?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm getting like a little nervous, but yeah.
and I want to just
kill him.
Crush.
Some of
my friends that have opened gyms might even be watching this.
No, I deleted them from Facebook. I'm too.
But there's a part where it's like, man, that's so great, good for you, I'm so happy for you, and now it's game on.
Yeah.
And I just had to go, no, yeah. And that was so traumatic to me that it was like, I'm going to remember every single person's name that I ever coach or come in contact with. And I'm not batting 1,000, but I do have a system, if you're really wondering. Proprietary information.
Go ahead, yeah. Facebook will protect you.
Yeah. And when somebody comes in, I have to make sure I'm not multitasking, because that's a deal, you know, that will ensure that you don't that you don't remember somebody's name. So, you know, off the phone, like look him in the eye. I have to make sure. I think half the time when we hear people's names, we don't really hear it. So a lot of times I'll have them repeated. If it's a weird name, I say, spell it for me. No joke. And I have the luxury at the gym of being able to write stuff on the board. And so if I can look him in the eye, if I can understand their name clearly, and then if I can use it 3 times in that hour, I'll never forget it. And if I don't do those things, then there's 100% chance that I'll forget it.
Have you guys noticed this? You know, talking about, like, you always make some point to the new people, too. Like, good job, you know, Johnny or Steven. And there's a guy up there, his name is spelled, and he's his teacher, the coach. His name is spelled Camron. How would you pronounce that? Camron.
Cameron.
Wrong. It's Cameron.
Yeah.
And I remember the first time I heard he goes, Cameron, good job. There you go, it's Cameron. Damn, that's like next level name, remember. So
now there have been a couple
of
times.
You're the guy from Austin Powers, 3 times.
Yeah. Where I've gone through this process, but it wasn't actually their name. And so I've called them the wrong name for months, right? And I was so certain of it.
It really is just Cameron.
That they can you imagine somebody calling you the wrong name for 6 months and you don't correct them? Whose fault is that? Is it mine or is it theirs?
Well, theirs.
They should have changed her.
If a guy in a tank top had just said he would kill you if you compete against him, because he calls you the wrong name, you just say yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay, so back to CrossFit and the culture you built and the confidence and the ethos and the hubris that you exemplify. Thank you. So there's 14,999 other companies in your field and growing. What's your difference maker? How do you guys stand out? How do you know that no matter what, you're going to have your audience, your crowd, they're going to be loyal, and you can go to bed at night knowing that?
Yeah, that's a great question, and very relevant to kind of where we're at in our culture and everything. And so, how do I sum this up? Part of it is being a radical, and a radical in the definition of that word is different than what you think it is. You know, it's not being a rebel, but it's the real definition of that word is being connected to the roots of something. That's really like the etiology of what that word means. And so the roots of this movement look a lot different than what the landscape of CrossFit currently is, where somebody just kind of walks into a gym and you're like, good luck, brother, you know. And the majority of the time, you have to be a special person. Like you describe that first experience, you have to be a special person to actually stick around. It's like the, you know, it's like the athletic development program for China. You know, it's like one person makes it to the Olympics and everybody else dies. You know, that's basically like the, what I'm trying to say is you're like a Chinese Olympian.
Very tall.
Yeah.
But I think that, I think this industry, and you kind of heard like our origin story, like it's so fun and it's cool that there's a lot of people that have gotten into this that are no longer doing it because they figured out that like they didn't have what it takes to keep going. And we've talked about this before, you know. And I don't think this is just unique to CrossFit. I think this is for anyone who's an entrepreneur, anyone who's in business for themselves.
Tell them the quote.
Okay. You know, the statistic I've heard is that how many small businesses make it to the 10-year mark? What do you think, percentage-wise? How many make it?
Less than five. Single digits.
10%?
Yeah, it's 4%.
Wow.
It's 4%. And so Sam and I have taken this on as kind of like our, you know, our mantra that being an entrepreneur and making it to these certain demarcations means that you're a gladiator. You know, the only sport where there's a 96% fatality rate is being a gladiator, right? And so when we, and this is a long way to answer your question, you know, but we have to be like professionals at what we do. I think it's easy to get into this industry and just be like a gym rat. It's like, oh, this is awesome. I get to wear Vans and board shorts, and I can take a nap in the afternoon. But I got three kids, you know? Like, I'm in this for life. And so some of the way that you frame what you do has to change, you know? So instead of being an exercise instructor or a personal trainer, I think we have to change the industry that we're really in. There are projected to be over 150 million Americans that have diabetes in the next like 10, 15 years. I mean, it's staggering, right? The fitness industry is a trillion-upon-trillion-dollar industry. It's grown $1 trillion in the last year. That means it's grown $1 million times $1 million. I mean, my brain can't even like understand those numbers, but there's a discrepancy between the two, right? There's a discrepancy between what the gyms are doing and that the fact that we're getting fatter and more unhealthy. And I think the disconnect and where we're going, and ultimately the answer to your question, is that we need to be the first line of defense before medical intervention. And so that's a lot bigger picture than like, hey, come and do thruster races with us at CrossFit. It is so much that encompasses that, right? It's taking care of every single thing that you need in order to be healthy, which is a lot more than just showing up at an hour class a few times a week. And so I think we honor like the past and where we've come, and you hang on to the good stuff, right? CrossFit to me is community. That's what those two things are. You hang on to that, but you try to have a more professionalized product that doesn't just make people happy to be a part of, but it like changes their life for the better. And so our vision for the next year, and hopefully for like the next 10 years, is to do just that. That you guys are members of the gym, like you wouldn't notice that anything really changes from what you like. You know, the stuff you love, it's still there. But then we're equipped in ways that we've never been to be the professionals that everybody needs in order to be as healthy as they possibly can. Which is like a tall order based on those statistics, you know? I think that whole culture is stigmatized to a certain extent. You know, it's like if you boast of anything physical, it means that you're vain or narcissistic. And some of that has to do with the fact that most of our jobs outside of mine, like, has to do with your intellect. It has to do with things that aren't physical in nature. But I think everybody here knows, like, the deep connection of how healthy you are to how well you perform with whatever you're doing. So everything that we're doing in the next calendar year, like, revolves around that. And I'm more excited than I've been in a long, long time to, like, make that happen.
What's your favorite part about what you get to do?
One of my favorite parts is having guys like Chad or Steven that work with me that I get to take care of, to have like a staff that is an extension of like my family, you know, and I think that's such a cool responsibility, and it's such a cool privilege to have guys that trust me and say like, hey, like, even some of the stuff we're talking about, you know, it's kind of vague, but to, for them to say like, hey, whatever direction we're going, like, I know you got it, and for me to say like, yeah, I do got it, yeah, like, yeah, we can do this, you know, I think that's awesome. And then, as I said earlier, I still love coaching, and I think I love coaching because it's really cool to provide like one of the best hours of somebody's day, you know, and it has little to do with like the movements and stuff like that, but I love rolling the door open at 5:30 or 5, right, and just waiting for people to show up. It's like, I can't wait for these guys to get here. I can't wait for me to impact the trajectory of the day they're about to have, you know, and I think that's more about them and like the relationship and just like being put in a position and being like, once again, like given responsibility and people like trusting me to do that, you know. I love that. I've never gotten tired of it.
Yeah. You feel like you've now figured out what your gift is? What's your gift?
I love to learn, and so I think part of how we've developed over the years has always been prioritized on like continuing my education, and so that'll always be a differentiator. You know, like I said, I want to crush people. Here's another thing that I would only say between you and me, but I'll say it in front of the camera. I know more than the rest of them. Like, I feel really confident in that, you know? Like, I feel like if two of us were standing toe-to-toe, it's like, it's not even a question. Like, I got this, right? And so I always know that, like, I'm doing more research, more learning than the next person. And I think about that constantly. You know, like, I've never gotten bored learning more. Mm-hmm. You know, and then secondly, I think that I do have a soft spot for people and wanting to include them. I've always been maybe a little too sensitive to that, you know? But I use that to my benefit, I think, you know, versus being like a people pleaser or something. Maybe, you know,
also, if a 6'4" jack guy with sleeve tattoo says, come here, you're like, you're going to go, not because you necessarily, like, it's like, yes, sir, right? So you're an includer by force, too. my last question from a business perspective, and I remember where I was standing outside by the water tower on the way to the parking lot where I park, where Murph and I park, and he just kind of stopped me and just in typical Spencer fashion, he told me, he's like, you know, how many businesses make it past 10 years? And he said 4%. He said, how many businesses ever make more than $1 million? I think it was less than 1%. Over $1 million ever. And then my question to you is, you mentioned the gladiator mentality. What's your advice to an entrepreneur, whether it's an entrepreneurial mindset, someone who actually started a business, the 22 people that, you know, went and branched off and did their own, what's the advice to survive and to thrive, to make over $1 million, to last longer than 10 years and have success?
You know, for me, like, starting something because it was a passion, it came a point, and you hear this, and I think it's a lie. Hey, pick something that you're passionate about and never work a day in your life.
Yeah.
Like, that's not really true, you know? I think for anybody who's starting a business or is in the throes of being an entrepreneur, like, you have to work. You have to work hard. But you know what? It's great, because you wouldn't want it the other way, right? I think we're made to work hard. I think sometimes it's like, man, what would your dream life be? Like, drinking margaritas on the beach. Like, you could probably only do that for a week, and then you get really tired of it, you know? And then at some point, it's like, what do I do now? It's like, well, have a purpose. Okay. okay, well, what do you do with the purpose? Well, you work really hard to try to make that happen. And I think when you can frame being in a business for yourself like that, you can hustle, you know, and you can get up every single day, whether the motivation wanes or it's in full supply, which I think is a limited resource, right? And if you know that you're supposed to work hard and that's what you're here for, then you can make it through pretty much anything. And we've had some real ups and downs, but if I don't feel sorry for myself about it, it's like, well, absolutely. Absolutely we would have like ups and downs. Absolutely we would have a bad year. Absolutely we would have a great year. And just accept that as like what's supposed to happen. It's like, of course, well, what am I gonna do with this tomorrow? You know, I think that's been like, as we've made it past like the, you know, the golden years, and it's like, man, you, what are you gonna do? Am I gonna go get a job that I don't care about and do the same thing? I'm gonna work hard anyways. Like, I might as well find this sweet spot where it's like I'm passionate about it, and also I need to work really, really hard. Yeah, I think that's my answer.
That's good. What questions do you guys have? Your name, please.
Richard, it's Todd. No, I have a question for Spencer and Sam if he were here, but I first want to thank Steve for the coffee.
Steven. Good job, Daddy.
Hey, thank you.
You said Steven. Steven,
you're showing off.
Yeah.
He's writing on a whiteboard.
Yeah.
Let me check the card. I'm sorry. Yeah. Seriously, when you said when people came to you initially, you knew why they were there because they were coming from a website. When they come now, do you know where they're coming from?
No, it's drastically different now. And we have a much different onboarding process, right? So, and this still happens every once in a while, but it's significantly less than it was in the old days. But in the old days, someone would just show up. They would just walk in. And then it got to a point where friends would bring a friend. And it was my job to expose them to the mistress that is intensity, right? And I would try, they would come in, and I would try to break them off. Mm. That was my job. You know, not a great business model. It's like, hey, let me try to get people to really suffer.
Sign a waiver.
And so you fast forward to today, like there's a much wider net that's being cast for people that need. This is what CrossFit is, right? And it has a stigma, and it has like this weird connotation. This is what it really is. Hey, you need to exercise. You probably get bored with the same routine, so let's switch up the movements. And guy, you're probably super busy, so we can't spend like hours upon hours. So let's make the workouts kind of short. How do we do that? Well, let's just make it a little more potent, but not too potent, right? Just appropriate for you. And you want to be able to be ambulatory until you're old, right? So you need to move all your joints. You don't want to be sedentary. So let's make sure that everything that we do uses these ranges of motion and moves multiple joints at a time, because that's how our body works in the first place. That's all CrossFit is, right? They say it in a cute way of like
constantly varying functional movements executed on it.
But it's really just like move and switch. Just
that was
move.
Way too good.
Yeah, it's just movements up. So out of the back. It's really appealing to a much broader audience than it once did. You know, it used to be like somebody who was in shape, someone who knew they were about to get their ass kicked and they were okay with that. And someone with kind of like this renegade mentality of like, I want to do something that's kind of counterculture. And now it's much more accessible, it's much more appealing. And so the onboarding process to get people in has to change because of that. So it looks drastically different.
Long time fan, director. So tell us, you never went into it actually, but I think it's a wonderful story to talk about for others to learn about self-assessment, thinking about understanding yourself and what you're good at, and thinking, what would I be good at, and how effective would I be knowing my strengths? I think that's a great story to tell, because you talked about his attempt into the Olympics, and that, I think, is a great example of that type of story. Would you share it?
Sure, just that, I mean,
well, I mean, he told you to tell everyone about potentially being in the Olympics, never got to it, but I think that's your approach to why you went that direction was really powerful.
Yeah, so, you know, based on what I mentioned already about, you know, coming from a deficit and learning how to take care of myself better, and then CrossFit entered, and it was this indoctrination to so much, right? And so many different movements. It can be kind of overwhelming when you first start, because there is so much that you're being exposed to. But after a while, and anybody who's done CrossFit in here, like, they notice I say it, and they'll be like, yeah, I know what you mean. There's like, there's a laundry list of stuff that you're not good at, right? Because there is exposure to so many different things. But there's one or two things, when it comes out, you're like, that's my jam. I like that. And so I had a similar experience like all you guys have that had done CrossFit. And for me, it was a really small subset of things. It was power cleaning. That's when you take a bar from the ground and it ends up on your shoulder and you don't have to, you know, squat all the way. It was really, really, really short workouts. And I liked to run, but not long distance. It was short. And I found that I had like pretty good, like, the common theme of all this stuff is I had pretty good power, if we're using like technical terms. And, you know, as I trained longer, you know, like I got a little bigger and had a better body composition. And because of my height, one time Sam and I were going through customs in Canada, and the sweet lady at customs, she was like, "What sport do you play?" I was like, "I'm a bobsledder." and we, you know, we just kind of laughed. They were like, "Yeah, what an idiot," you know. And we went back home, and in my Providence, right, I was on the website, and I found out that the USA bobsled team has a combine, like the NFL, and it's open to anyone, which I thought, this is like too good to be true. And then I looked at the tests, one rep max power clean, 60 meter sprint, shot toss, broad jump, and I was like, I love this. This is great. And I was newly married at the time, but you know, one of the things with CrossFit is like, take the training you have, and go and learn and play new sports, right? That's one of the mantras. And so for our 1 year anniversary, I found one of these combines in Park City, and I was like, babe, I'm gonna take you to Park City. Our first anniversary, I don't want to skip. Take to a nice hotel, but I am going to be gone for 8 hours. and she's so cool. Like she had seen me like kind of do some other offshoots and play some other sports. She was like, fine, whatever. So she went with me. And interestingly enough, I was not as fast as the guys that were like pure sprinters that did the combine, and I wasn't as strong as like the weightlifters that did the power clean. But I was stronger than the runners, and I was faster than the lifters. And so my overall composite score came out like at a level where I qualified for housing at the Olympic Training Center, which I thought was really cool.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And yeah, and at that point I was like, man, this is so cool. Like I did that, great, check it off the list. And they called me a week later, and they said, hey, somebody got injured, and if you can pay for yourself to get up to Lake Placid, we'll let you try out for the team. So I was like, babe, I got to go to Lake Placid. United States is calling. anyways, I went up there. I was like, this is cool. You know, like, oh, I can see the leaves change. You know, it was like the fall, and I drove out there, and fly to Albany, you drive for 2 hours to Lake Placid. By the time I got there, it was after dark, and the guy that had called pulled me out to like the push track, you know, where they have like the sleds on railroad tracks so you can just practice. And he taught me how to push the sled. And so the next day, we had what's called a push off, where in bobsled, there's four people and a four man sled, and they put two teams together where only one person is different and the other three remaining members are the same. And so I had never worn or donned the apparel. I had never gone down a track, which is absolutely terrifying. And aggressively, like I kind of pictured it being like the Matterhorn ride at Disneyland, like smooth but kind of fast, and it is, it's like rolling down a hill in a trash can. Like it's aggressive. But anyways, I pushed the sled, I hopped in, we came down, and I beat the other guy by 0.02 seconds. And so I was on the bobsled team. And, you know, so at that point I was like, I'm a bobsledder. And I was able to kind of ride that for almost 3 years. And so I got in on a non-Olympic year, and much like skiing or other winter sports, like there's a cup series and there's like a World Cup. And so I got to participate in the America's Cup and the World Cup. And then for the Olympics, they whittled down the number of sleds that can get in. And so even the United States shrinks their team. And so you try out for the Olympics. And I went out for the Olympic trials and did not go to the Olympics. But when you hear the whole story, it's like, man, I was on borrowed time, you know. It's like, what was I even doing there? You know, I was a CrossFitter that like they got to just play another sport for a couple of years, and it was really cool to take that training and like catapult into something else. And also, many CrossFitters have since like done that. But once again, I was kind of like an early adopter. I was like the first one that wasn't. Most guys come from football or track and field.
Tell you about Johnny.
Yeah, that's how Johnny and I met. Yeah, I needed sprint training, so I went to Michael Johnson, and Johnny was there. And I was like, I'm here for bobsled. And they were like, so's that guy.
You remember the guy that was in the Olympics, Johnny Coyne, a few years ago, and he got locked in the bathroom door. He's a buddy of mine that brought him to CrossFit, and then they like saw each other. They had the bobsled handshake, and I was just left out. But anybody else have questions before we wrap it up?
One quick question. When did you guys start doing your own program?
Day one.
Was it day one?
Yeah. So, typical CrossFit gyms, you have like your own, so CrossFit.com, they do 3 days on and 1 day off. And since we were open 6 days, we had to come up with two more workouts. And so that's how it started. But from the get-go, the program design and the methodology behind that was always something that Sam and I were interested in. So, well, I think one of the reasons you get into this is so you can program yourself. It's the part that we were always pretty stoked about. Yeah. Yeah.
So how would people go and find you, people that are watching online that are going to watch this later? Website's CrossFitDallas.com?
DallasCrossFit.com or TrainCFDC.com.
And then physical locations?
Physical locations, we have one downtown on Elm Street next to Thanksgiving Tower, and then 5626 Fondren is where we work out, and it's our headquarters.
Watch it. Cool. Well, let's hear it for.
Yeah.
Did film it?
Yes.
Yeah, they already did.